I'm Ben Sidran, and you're about to hear an encore presentation of a conversation captured at an important moment in time. It was the 1980s, and jazz music was undergoing a major change. Many of the great stars of the past were in their final days, and many of the young lions were just starting to make their marks. One by one, they came into the studio and spent an hour with me, talking about their careers, their hopes, their place in the tradition, and their opinions on the music of the day. For more information on Talking Jazz, to purchase the Talking Jazz book of interviews, or just an audio copy of today's conversation, please visit TalkingJazz.com. That's www.talkingjazz.com. Miles Davis.
Okay, Ben, far away.
As we're talking, you're starting to do some drawing. You always been involved in drawing?
Yeah, my father taught my brother, me, brother, I showed my brother, how to sketch. Just started as a sketcher. My brother can see anything and draw it right off. But he doesn't have an imagination like I have.
So the imagination is...
In everything. Imagination.
That's my impression, that your drawings are like you're playing in some ways. It's
well, what it does is it's balanced. If you make a drawing, a sketch on a page, you have to balance it, you know? And that's the way most everything is. Art is. Like music, composition. Solos. Clothes, you know, when you dress up.
Balance.
Yeah. A little over here, a little there, a little there.
When I first noticed your sketching, of course, was on your albums as you started to introduce it. Mm-hmm. Is this something you've always done? Has it always been part of your artistic process, drawing?
Yeah. You know, I stopped a while, but when I laid off it, I really started to sketch again after I married Cicely, because she takes so long, actresses, they take so long to get ready for anything. You know, rather than scream at her, I just started sketching, especially on planes. After we had a close call going to Peru for the Miss Universe contest. The plane dropped about 2,500 feet, and then it dropped another 1,000 feet. You know, and everybody was, some people were crying, and then I started sketching, you know, because it really scared to see it. That's really a trip to do that. So now, when I fly from New York to California, sometimes I sketch. Most all the time I sketch. All the time I sketch. If I go to sleep, I'm sketching. And I've done sketches that took me 5 hours, you know, to finish. But it relaxes you, you know.
You're spending most of your time in California now?
Most of the time. I try to. I try to stay here because of my circulation. Good for my circulation. The cold weather really does a number on my skin, and in New York, the air's dirty, the streets are dirty. But that pace in New York, I love that pace. So I would never just live out here all seasons, just in the wintertime. Either there or the south of France.
You really are a part of the greater art community, not just the music community. You're one of the few musicians in American jazz to have made that transition.
From what to what?
From being thought of as a player to being thought of as an artist.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, that's... If I was thought of anywhere else than that, you know, I wouldn't want to be here. If I couldn't contribute. You know, I was telling... some friends in Sweden. If I if I couldn't do anything, you know, like help, if I was in it, and it said some other form of art, if I couldn't discover something or help the art, a new way to do this, you know, like that, I wouldn't want to be here. You know, I would just want to be dead if I couldn't create. That's what I'm trying to say. If I couldn't create, I wouldn't. It would be nothing for me to live for, you know? If I couldn't like maybe write a composition that I'd like, not somebody else, you know, I would like, and my friends would like. And they said, yeah, Miles, that's good. If I couldn't do that, I wouldn't want to be here. It's selfish, I know, but geniuses are selfish.
Part of your genius has been, it seems, to take groups of musicians and put them in challenging situations. Looking back over the output of your recorded work, the newness a lot of times stands out as much as anything. The fact that you're creating situations that force musicians to rely on their instincts rather than their habits.
That's right. It's the group of people that you associate with. It's, you know, it's not all me, you know, it's them. People like Herbie Hancock, those people that I work with, Chick Corea, and recently Randy Hall and Zane, they're talented people, especially when they get in their creative period, you know. You know, people have creative periods where they like that, you know, and then they could just wait on that or recognize it when it's there. I recognize it in other people, you know. I recognize it in Wayne Shorter and Herbie, Chick, Keith Jarrett, Sonny Rollins, different people, you know, Philly Joe, and Red Garland, Randy, even Adam. Adam's a genius with the keyboards and stuff. You know, like David Porter and what's the other guy's name? St. Clavier, he plays that, you know, has a reputation. And George Duke, you know, a lot of guys are like that. You know, you just have to. I asked George to send me something, you know?
I heard it.
Did you hear it? Isn't that nice?
It's beautiful.
He is something else, man. But see, I saw that, I heard that. You know, he reminds me so much of Herbie. You know, if Herbie would just slow down a little bit, you know. George is quite talented. Like a potato chip.
Again, part of the message of your music seems to be yourself, and the minimalism of your own music, the pretty notes, as opposed to a lot of notes.
Pretty notes. And if you play a sound, you have to pick out, it's like the eye of the hurricane, you know, you have to pick out the most important note that fertilizes the sound. You know what I mean? It makes the sound grow, you know, and then it makes it definite so your other colleagues can hear and react to it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
If you play what's already there, they know what's there, you know? The thing is to bring it out, you know what I mean? It's like putting lemon on fish or vegetables. It brings out the flavor. And that's what they call pretty notes. You know, they're just major notes that should be played, you know, in rhythms and stuff. I used to, a lot of times I would tell Herbie to lay out, he wrote a couple of pieces that were up in tempo. And rather than have him play the sound for me, I played the sound for him to listen to, you know, the composition he wrote. Because if you have a lot of too much background, you can't play an up-tempo and really do what the composer tries to give to me, and I try to give fans, music lovers.
You talk about the sound of the composition as if a song or composition has a central sound to it, a sound source.
I try to get his sound, whoever's writing the composition. If I'm going to play something against that, I have to get the sound that he wants in there without destroying and blowing over it, so that not to bury it. You know what I mean? So it takes a lot of, it really takes a long time to do that, you know. If you lean in that way, it's not. But if you aren't, somebody tells you. When I was about 15, a drummer, I was playing a number in the Castle Ballroom in St. Louis. We had a 10-piece band. 3 trumpets, 4 saxophones, you know. And he asked me, he said, "Little Davis, won't you play that what you played last night?" I said, "What? What do you mean, what?" He said, "You don't know what it is?" I said, "No, what is it?" He said, "You were playing something coming out of the middle of the tune, and then play it again." I said, "I don't know what I play." He said, "If you don't know what you're playing, then you ain't doing nothing." Well, that hit me, you know. I'm like, bam. So I went and got everything, every book that I could get to learn about theory. To this day, I know what he's talking about. You know, I know what note he was talking about. You know?
What note was it?
It was a raised ninth. I mean, flatted ninth.
This conversation about the sound of the composition brings to mind the recording Kind of Blue. Kind of Blue is the number one jazz record on virtually all the critics' lists. When you see the list published of your 10 most favorite records, Kind of Blue is always on those lists.
Isn't that so?
Does the success of that record surprise you, Miles? It seems like such a simple record to have made in a way.
Not back then. Because Bill Evans is one of my all-time favorite pianists, Bill Evans. His approach to the piano just brought that piece out. Because he used to bring me pieces by Ravel, Concerto for Left-Handed Orchestra. You heard that? What's a piece? Ravel's friend went to the army and came back. He was a pianist, but he lost his right hand, so he wrote a piece for left hand and orchestra for piano. And Bill used to tell me about different modes, which I already knew. And we just agreed on something, and that's the way the album went. We were just leaning toward like Ravel and playing a sound with only the white keys, you know, Dorian minor modes, and it just came out. It was just a thing to do. You know what I mean? Like an architect, all of a sudden, all of the architects in the world would start making circles. You know, like Frank Lloyd Wright, all his colleagues that are leaning that way thought the same way at the same time, you know? And it was made for Coltrane.
Yes.
You know, that kind of thing. Because I used to give him a lot of chords. I'd give him like 5 chords. In one, and I told him you can play either one, you know. So he was the only one could do that. But that's, I got it from Rachmaninoff modulating from key to key. Bill and I used to bar talk. Who wrote the Fire Dance?
Oh, yeah, Catch a Tour.
Yeah, Catch a Tour. I would give Train a little chords like that to play, you know, and would against one sound. You know, like it's just, if you, instead of saying D, D dominant seven, something like that, you could play under the chord, over the chord, you know, a minor third up in all chord, a minor third up from the fifth of the chord, you know. But it has to be a dramatic player like Train was, who can just turn you on with a sound of one note and a group of notes. Only two people I ever heard doing that was Charlie Parker and Coltrane. You know, that's the only two I ever heard in my life do that.
The similarity between those players, the rhythmic freedom and the way they run changes.
Train didn't start playing like that till I got him a girlfriend of mine in France. One day she said, "Miles, these guys want to talk to you. They want to give you a trumpet or something." So I said, "I don't feel like talking to anybody." She said, "They just want to talk to you and maybe you can pick out a couple of trumpets that you want." Yeah. So I said, "Okay." So I also got a soprano sax with Train. He never put it down. We was on a tour with Norman Grant. He played the soprano sax in the bus, in the hotel, every day, all day, 24 hours. And he got that sound, you know. And then I gave him those chords, and he just went, you know. Because he wasn't playing like that, you know. Sometimes when a player plays so loud that it locks him with the sound that he left. You're like, bam! You know, it blocks out everything else. So I gave him all these options. I mean, it sounds technical. You have to think like that if you're an artist, you know. You have to know how to do different things.
Hearing you talk about this session, I'm struck by the fact that, like Duke Ellington, you would prepare music for your players rather than bring music to them and say, play this. That the music really does come out of the people you're hanging out with and recording with.
Yeah, that's right. Well, Duke is one of my favorite composers. You know, Just lately, I've been hearing in my head Rain Check that he wrote. His name was.
You mentioned Coltrane's sound on the soprano saxophone. At one point, Coltrane said that he had been hearing a higher sound. It wasn't until he had his hands on the soprano that he actually was able to realize what he'd been hearing in his head.
Right. See, it takes a long time for guys to develop. You know what I mean?
How come nobody can get your sound? It's a simple gesture, it seems, but it's very difficult.
I have my own sound because when I was like this, my trumpet instructor, I loved the way his sound, you know. He was black and he used to play with Andy Kirk, and he played in the low registers of like Harold Baker, and you know, I just leaned toward that cornet sound. You know, like Nat Allen plays called. But it's just a sound. And it's, you know, it's just popular. You know, like years ago, composers, the reason Beethoven was reading, you read about Beethoven because he was the one that they could understand. The other ones, you know, that they couldn't understand, they didn't. That he mentioned. So my tone must be the easiest for somebody to hear. You know, like Louis Armstrong and that kind of sound.
Mm-hmm.
But see, your sound is like, you know, it's like your sweat. You know, your sound. Lester Young had his sound. Eddie Davis, Coleman Hawkins, Browning, Clifford Browning, Fats LaVera, you know? There's no more sound. Freddie has a sound, but it, during those days when you didn't hear anybody to copy, guys got their own sound, but now that you have so many records and cassettes, it's no more sound. They copy it. They copy the sound. You know what I mean? Huh. That's the reason they can put the sound in a keyboard. But it's a white sound in the keyboard. You know, it's a white trumpet player sound in the keyboard for trumpet.
They can't put the black sound in the keyboard.
Nobody's done it yet. I put it in. I put my sound in it.
You mean sampling, a sampling computer?
Yeah. But if you just buy a keyboard, it has a white sound, trumpet player.
That's an interesting point, though, that before there was such wide recording distribution, people were forced to develop their own sounds.
Forced to play without... They didn't have anything to listen to, you know? But you watch guys play an instrument and you like the attitude, the concept, the way it looks, the way they hold it, the way they dress. But nowadays, you know, they have... I saw three trumpet players in Lionel Hampton's band. And they were white, right? They all sound alike. They all sound like Wynton. He doesn't have a distinguished sound, but Freddie almost has. Woody Shaw has real creative type trumpet player. He's like Dizzy, you know. They might do anything. I mean, you still can get a good solo out of Dizzy. He's like, he really turned my brain in Charlie Parker and, you know, those guys. They did a number on my head, you know, as far as me learning. You
know. How did they do it?
It just opened it up.
Just hearing it.
But what they were thinking, it put a stamp on what I was thinking, that it was okay to, you know, go like that. Trumpet players now, Freddie almost has his own sound. I still can't tell him. Maybe if I listen to him a bit more. But it's now that Fats LaVera had that sound. Here's in Browning, and that's the same style.
You mentioned people getting excited about watching a player, and I remember you saying at one point, well, you can know everything you need to know about how I play by watching how I stand.
It's a certain way, like when I play, sometimes if I play like that high from the floor, it's another sound that you can get.
Right, when you get over and put the bell right off of the floor.
And it's, you know, maybe one over there, maybe one up there, but I never go any higher than that, you know, sitting straight up maybe. But I found out in Juilliard, that if I stayed any longer, you know, I was gonna have to play like a white man, you know, and I was gonna have to act like a white man toward music, the direction, you know what I mean? So I left, you know, because there were certain things you had to do, a certain way you had to play. To get in there and to be with them, and I didn't come all the way from St. Louis just to be with a white orchestra. You know, I turned down a lot of those, but I found out, you know, that I could go my own way. I had to catch up. My friend Freddie Webster, I said, Freddie, I'm going to St. Louis, and he was one of those guys. I said, man, you know, if you go to St. Louis, back to St. Louis. And them Hoogees and crackers there, you're gonna get mad and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, you might get killed. So I said, no, I'm gonna tell, I have to go to tell my father that I'm gonna leave Juilliard. He said, why don't you call him up? I said, not my father. I can't call him up and say, I'm going with Bird, and they do this, and Dizzy is this. You know, a professional man, he was a surgeon, right?
Yeah, I know.
So I called the, he said, okay. So I called the train. I went in his office. He looked up and said, what the fuck are you doing here? As soon as you get through, he was, you know, working on a great patient. He was a dental surgeon. So when he got through, I said, this music is happening, Juilliard isn't, and I'm down on this, on the street where everything's happening. More so, I'm learning more down there what I want to do, about what I want to do than in Juilliard. You know, my trumpet instructor Juilliard is still in the Philharmonic Orchestra in New York. I think Wynton, you know, took some lessons from him. But I couldn't do that, you know. So he said, okay. So I said, save your money, you know. So that was it. But I couldn't stay. Damn, I'm messing up something. I couldn't phone him from New York and tell him that. Duke Ellington, he knew, but not Dizzy and Bird and Monk and Coleman Hawkins. Although we did have a record of Coleman Hawkins playing by himself. And Art Tatum. That's the only records we had in our house. We had MJ Blues by Duke with Jimmy Bland. Bland is from St. Louis, Mountain.
Uh-huh.
And Duke Ellington, that's it. And Art Tatum. Oh yeah, and I had Bird on with Jay McShann, Hootie Blues.
Oh yeah.
And Basie, yeah, we had quite a few. Well, that was after I knew what I wanted to hear. Cause those bands, those days, Earl Hines and those Jimmy Lockton, Sonny Stitt was with the McKinley Cotton Pickers, and they had heard about me in St. Louis, and they wanted me to go, and my mother wouldn't let me go. I said, oh, shit.
You got there by going to Juilliard, in other words.
Right.
Yeah. These days you're talking about seem so far away from today. The times, the way music was treated by players.
Yeah, I know. Something else gets in your mind, in my head, but those are good memories for me, you know?
It seems today people musicians do have difficulty keeping interested in the music when in the past it was everything.
You know, it's because they don't take time out to learn different things, you know? They wouldn't see Adam in here. I teach him different chords and stuff to play when we play. I teach him what I know about what I play. And musicians nowadays, they wouldn't take the time out to do that. Oh, so a jazz musician that you call a jazz musician. I was reading this damn thing in the Times about jazz legends. They shouldn't have to call up people and ask them, can we play here and stuff like that. You know, I don't do that. I would never do that. You know, I didn't get in music, you know, just to make money and stuff like that. If I wanted to make money, I'd know what to do, you know. I used to rehearse with Mingus and Buddy Collette in 1947 here. I stayed a year here. You know?
I just saw an album cover, a picture of you and Chet Baker and somebody else, I forget.
Rolf Erickson, maybe.
Maybe so. It seems a major thing has happened to all music, not just jazz, and that is its move from music that was captured in a recording studio to music that was manufactured in this recording studio. It's a whole different premise now.
We don't do that. We sequence the layers of orchestration, and we play the same thing in person, but only we goose it a little bit. You know what I mean? You're free to improvise.
In talking to John Scofield at one point, he described recording with you that at one point you were rehearsing, and that he had just played a line at your house, and he came in the next day, and that was the tune.
John is very melodic. Only drummer John has, he played behind, too far behind the beat. After he was getting out of that.
How is recording a record like You're Under Arrest now, which is a large process, and different from the way you used to make a record where you come in with some tunes and go out?
It's easier.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Because Randy, Randy and Zane and Adam, I'll show Adam what I want, write it out, play it. He'll play it when we get to the studio. When I get there, all of that is in the on tape. You know, it feeds right to the board, and all I have to do is play over. It's easy like that. I like to went crazy trying to make D-chord. I mean, I threw everything out, and we just start from scratch. I just take studio, Adam, we use a drum machine to keep it in, because I tried to put things together and decoordinate, you know, the ones that didn't have it in the drum machine, the tempo was doing this and that. Musicians feel sad, they have personalities like Al Foster, like some of them want to play and it's no part for them, you know, I can see they don't feel it. But rather than wait for two and three sessions for them to feel like it and learn the composition, how to add to the composition, rather playing over it like a lot of guys do. They play too many fucking notes. Like Mike Stern, I tell him all the time, I say, Mike, you need to go to Notes Anonymous. You know, like AAA. I mean, it's much easier now for me. Because, you know, like a guy like George Duke, he writes the composition, it's all there, you just put play on it. And respect the man's, you know, composition, you know? But you have to pick the people that you want. You see, my voice is changing because, you know, this is very touchy with me. You know, I don't want to fire him. I don't want to fire him. But I do want, when a person writes a composition, you have to let that composition soak in. You know what I mean? You have to try to see or hear what the composer wanted. You know? And you have to play that style. You know? Not that you're just going to play your style in somebody else's music. If they compose it, they didn't want that kind of thing in there. You know, and you're gonna do it on every number. So, we don't need that. Or if you're in a rhythm section and the tempo drops, you get mad because somebody tells you the tempo drop, we don't need that. We have time, and it's right there. You know, long as electricity is on, the tempo is like that. You know, and you don't have to use an excuse like, I can't play with the drum machine, you know? And it's no excuse. If you're a musician, if you love music, you would want body and soul to sound like body and soul. Or you would want for human nature to sound like human nature that Michael did, you know?
Well, what about Body and Soul? What about those pretty songs?
Those songs, to me, don't exist. you know, we don't have time for body and soul, and I got rhythm, you know? Or so what? All kind of blues. Those things are there. They were done in that area, the right hour, the right day, and it happened. It's over. It's on the record. You know, people ask me, why don't you play this? Go buy the record. It's still there. What you like is on the record. You don't like me. But I don't want you to like me now. Unless you like the music. You know, don't like me because I'm kind of blue. Like me for what I'm, you know, for what we're doing, you know. I was put here to play music and interpret music. That's what I do. No attitude, nothing. That's all I want. And I do it good, you know, because my colleagues say, yeah. You know what I mean? And that's enough for me to keep doing what I do, you know. I stopped playing trumpet. Dizzy came over my house and said, what the fuck is wrong with you? Are you crazy or something? I said, man, you better get out of here. He said, no, I'm not either. Mm-hmm. He's like my brother, you know. But that's it for me, you know. All the rest, people think I do this, I do that, I do that. Yeah, I do that and this. You know, I might do a lot of things, but the main thing that I love that comes before everything, even breathing, is music. That's it. You know, nothing. You know, I buy Ferraris, cars, a box, yeah, but music is always there, right there.
And that means you're going to have to keep hanging out with musicians.
That's
and you're
right.
Going to have to keep your ear tuned to the radio, and you're going to have to plug in all the latest machines.
Right.
Because you can't go back.
Mm-mm. I can.
As we've been sitting here talking, you've been drawing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost been one gesture, drawing and talking. It's the same
right.
thing.
Same thing.
Is there a record that you really want to make that you haven't made? Are you going towards something in your head? Or are you just doing it as it comes?
No, I got something in my head that I'm getting ready to show Adam. And it's nice, you know, I love it. I love to feel like this. It's something that knocks me out.
I got one more question for you.
Mm-hmm.
The song Nardis. How did you happen to name it Nardis? Do you remember?
No, I can't remember. It might have something to do with nuclear.
It was a long time ago, I guess.
I know, I did for Cannibal. I think I just like the name. What does it mean?
I don't know, but it's my last name backwards.
Again. I don't know, but that's a nice name. Again.
For more information on Talking Jazz, to purchase the Talking Jazz book of interviews, or just an audio copy of today's conversation, please visit TalkingJazz.com. That's www.talkingjazz.com. I'm Ben Sidran. Hope you enjoyed the hour and that you'll join me next time for another in-depth interview with one of the great names in jazz. Until then, keep listening, keep swinging, and keep on talking jazz.